Hi, and welcome everyone to the Alternative Fuel and Infrastructure webinar. This is the first installment in the Sustainable Transportation, a virtual educational series for fleets presented in partnership with the Transportation and Innovation Partners, Alliant Energy, the City of Madison, Madison Gas and Electric, and Wisconsin Clean Cities. You're invited to join us at 1 p.m. Central each Thursday during the six-week series for a virtual educational series on a variety of sustainable transportation topics with the top experts in the industry. It's a great opportunity to learn from others who have experienced success in the realm and to become inspired to take action and to become more sustainable in your own organizations. My name is Kelly Verbeck, and I'm the program specialist with Wisconsin Clean Cities, and I will serve as moderator for today's event. We are looking forward to a great series, and we're so glad to have you with us today. Today, you'll be hearing from industry experts on the latest in alternative fuels and infrastructure. Our speakers include Chris Schmale of Renewable Energy Group, Jason Vanderbrink of Ozinga, and Steve Whaley of Propane and Education Research Council. We're excited to present this great lineup of speakers with you today. So before we go ahead and introduce the presenters, I'd like to launch our first poll. So the first poll is, what is your involvement in the industry? So go ahead and choose whichever option best suits you. Go ahead and give it a few more seconds. We appreciate your answers. Okay, so it looks like we have a lot of utility and energy providers with us today, so that's great. We do appreciate you taking that poll. And before I introduce our first speaker, I'm going to launch one more poll. So this one is, what is your company organization's involvement with alternative fuels in your fleet? So it's distributing right now. A few more seconds here. Great, thank you for submitting those answers. That really does help us get to know who's with us today, so we appreciate that. We do plan to address many of your questions related to alternative fuels and infrastructure during the presentations today. However, we will also be hosting a live Q&A session at the end of the presentation, so please make sure to type your questions into the chat box or question box, and we will make sure to get to as many as we can. Now I'd like to go ahead and introduce our first speaker, Chris Schmale of REG. Chris is the Senior Fuels Sales Development at REG and will be sharing his expertise with us on renewables.
Well, thanks, Kelly. I appreciate it, and I appreciate all of you joining us here today, along with our other panelists. Like Kelly said, my name is Chris Schmale. I'm with Renewable Energy Group. We are based in Ames, Iowa, and have operations coast to coast in a few other countries in Europe. I've been with the company for about 8 years. And have done several different things within the sales department. But today I'm going to talk to you guys really about just some biodiesel basics. I never want to assume that you know all there is to know about biodiesel. So I'm going to start off with some simple things and just kind of give you a higher level view of what biodiesel is and really try to just drill down for you guys how easy it is to use and how simple it is to get from a supply standpoint, and just talk about some of those types of things on top of the benefits from it. So that's kind of going to be what we go over today. So first thing, you know, what is biodiesel? It is, in short, I mean, you can have several different definitions, but really it's just a renewable fuel that is made from waste vegetables and fats and oils and those types of things that you see on here. And really from a chemical engineering standpoint, it's a simple process. It's not simple for someone like me, or if you've ever seen a biodiesel plant and all the piping and all the things that go into it. But from a pure chemical engineering standpoint, you're simply taking that fats and those fats and oils, like a triglyceride, and you're adding a catalyst to it. In this case, an alcohol called methanol. And what that does is forms a reaction that's called transesterification. And it separates those fatty acid chains from each other and forms a methyl ester, which is the name for biodiesel in the scientific realm. So it's a simple process from that standpoint, and you know it's something that that you know we've tried to perfect over the years. I will say this: one of the reasons, you know, some of you may have heard about the issues that the industry had 12, 13, 14, 15 years ago. And it's because there was some bad stuff out on the market. And a lot of it was because people were trying to do it on their own because they thought it was simple enough to do on their own. And there wasn't regulation and standards and that type of thing. And so what I will tell you is that biodiesel is one of the most heavily regulated and standardized fuels from an ASTM standpoint that you'll see in this country. And the guidelines and the testing standards are extremely high as we move here into 2020, and they have been for quite a long time. So some of the benefits of biodiesel, it's an oxygenated fuel, which means that, you know, you're going to get reduced tailpipe emissions out of it. Sulfur and carbon monoxide and hydrocarbon particulates are going to be reduced. It's going to burn the fuel more thoroughly and cleaner, so you don't have as much coming out of your exhaust. It enhances lubricity, as you guys know from going to ultra low sulfur diesel several years ago. It kind of took the lubricity out of the petroleum diesel, and biodiesel adds that back in, so you don't have to use a lubricity additive. It's excellent to blend with petroleum diesel or renewable diesel, which REG also produces. And so you can blend it with any one of those fuels if you want to. It's comparable when you're transporting it, and I'm talking about 100% biodiesel, B100. When you're transporting it, it's comparable to vegetable oil, and those types of handling requirements, and not an actual, fuel. So it's less hazardous when you're transporting it as just a B100. And then it can be blended, as I said, with any level of diesel or renewable diesel. 20% is getting more and more common as the maximum general purpose for use. We have people that do it at 50% or, you know, higher than that sometimes, but really your most common is 20% or below, depending on what part of the country you're in and where you're at. In the colder states or the northern part of the country, you see a lot of people that blend at 20% in the summer and then drop down to 11 or 10% or even 5% in the winter, just depending on what kind of fuel they're using, what kind of feedstock the fuel comes from, and those types of things. And the other thing is that we've found that when we blend the biodiesel with renewable diesel, it performs at a higher level. And there's some tests that we have that we run a lot that proves that and shows that. And then the biodiesel, renewable diesel blends can have a lower freezing point than just straight renewable diesel if you're looking at renewable diesel. And I know renewable diesel is not something that's a big thing here yet in the Midwest. A lot of it's out on the West Coast and other places, but it's just something to keep in mind as we move forward. So these are just, you know, some emissions data. You see the this is a percentage of reduction if you're using a B100 or a B20. Obviously, that percentage reduction ebbs and flows with whatever blend you're using. So just, you know, I think one of the themes you're going to see from all of us here today on the panel is that all of our fuels, you know, reduce emissions and carbon footprint. And this is just a simple chart or graph to show some of the biodiesel stats and basics. One of the things that, you know, we talk about, you know, you're going to hear about different types of fuels, and I think we all have a space in this world to have our fuel be used. I think we all share a common goal. One of the things that we've seen over the past, you know, several years is that there's still a strong demand for biodiesel. 97% of the Class 8 trucks rely on diesel fuel. That could change as there's more conversions to other types of fuels. We understand that. But we also saw between 2012 and 2018, 111% increase in biodiesel consumption. So, you know, demand remains high for us, and we think it will be for quite some time. This is just something, this is a little bit of a, it's not the most current map I wanted to show you. It's probably a year and a half to 2 years old, but this is, all the blue dots are U.S. retailers that are selling biodiesel blends between B10 and B20. And I would venture to say if I was going to show you a September 10th, 2020 map, there'd be a lot more blue dots on here. But it's just, I wanted to put this in here just to show you, all of you, that if you're traveling or if you have diesel trucks on the road and you're filling up at, you know, truck stops and C-stores and that type of thing, the chances of you, especially in certain parts of the country, using biodiesel already are pretty high. And, you know, particularly in the Midwest, along the East Coast, out in the West Coast and the Pacific Northwest. So it's, even if you don't think it's readily available, you might be using it without even knowing it. And you're starting to see more and more stickers on pumps because people are blending at a higher than B5 level. So just an illustration to kind of show that. And, you know, if we're talking about infrastructure, and that's one of the things we're discussing here, there's already, just from a retail standpoint, good infrastructure throughout this country, and we're trying to make it better. So just REG overview, just so some of you guys know a little bit about us. We've been in the industry for over 20 years. We started out as a division of a co-op here in Iowa called West Central, which is now Landis Co-op. So we spun out of that and became REG back in 2006. And now, you know, we have over 500 million gallons of nameplate capacity. The biodiesel industry by itself is probably close to 3 billion gallons in this country. So we have a nice share of that. We offer biodiesel, renewable diesel, petroleum diesel blends, and just blended fuel. The more in our fuel lineup there is more on the backside, where, you know, when you offer the biodiesel process, there's glycerin and there is all these other co-products that come off of that process that we also sell into the marketplace. And then the cool thing about REG, I've always thought, is that our technical support staff, our lab staff, is works hand in hand with our sales team to make sure that any issues you guys have, anything like you know, technical issues, engine issues, whatever, we have a bunch of experts that live and work in that world every day that are available to help and solve issues if there is any. So as I said, you know, as we kind of throw out our marketing campaign, which is called Fuel Forward, in 2019, we sold over 700 million gallons of biodiesel, you know, and we produced almost 500 million gallons of it. So you can see that we sell everything we produce and then some. There's, you know, 4.2 metric tons of carbon reduction in those gallons and in those sales. And so just something that we like to talk about because we think we're doing good things for the environment, and we hope to continue to do more as we move forward. And then just our production and distribution, this map shows just, it doesn't do it justice with how many terminals and things like that we have. Our other one that we had before we updated it is a little bit more busy and kind of does it more justice, but just from an infrastructure standpoint, we have 13 biodiesel refineries or renewable diesel refineries around the country, two more in Europe. We have 45 terminals that sell either B100 or blended fuel or diesel fuel from coast to coast. We've sold in 49 states, in 6 Canadian provinces and 10 other countries. So it's a coast to coast operation. It's a global operation in many instances. And just wanted to give you guys an idea of the scope of what we're doing on a daily basis here. So as we move on, I want to talk about just in your neck of the woods, specifically for you guys in Wisconsin. As you know, we have a biodiesel refinery in Madison, or in DeForest. We call it REG Madison. We attach our names to kind of the biggest metro area around where our plants are. And so REG Madison is located in DeForest. We bought the plant in 2007 from Sanimax. It was built by Sanimax in 2007. We acquired it in 2016. Completed some renovations in 2019 and continue to produce at, you know, full capacity here in 2020. So it's a great plant for us in a good location. You can just see the national impact here of Madison over time with the amount of feedstock that we purchase, the amount of locations we're purchasing from, and the value added into the economy, the amount of biodiesel that we produce. And again, all trying to get back to the point for you guys that infrastructure for biodiesel is strong, not just with us, but with our competitors that have refineries as well. And so it's something that the fuel should be simple and easy for you to get to and to use as you move forward. As far as the state impact of REG Madison, it supports 25 direct jobs. We purchased out of those 155 million pounds of feedstock that you saw on the last slide, 70 million pounds of that was from Wisconsin vendors, which was, you know, $15 million in added value to the economy. And I think that's one important thing, is that we really take that part seriously and want to be good local stewards of you know, the economy and the states that we operate in. So the last couple slides are just simple sustainability, you know, things that we talk about. You know, as most of you know, the transportation industry is the largest source of emissions in the US. And so as we've gotten into things, you know, talking about climate change and different you know, countries and different states and municipalities having sustainability goals and those types of things, you're also getting customers that are demanding sustainability, and you're getting a regulatory push from, you know, local, state and federal governments to have more sustainability. And so on top of the fact that obviously we want to sell our fuel and have our fuel in the market, we think it's a good option for our customers from a sustainability standpoint too, to meet some of their goals and their standards. And that's really what we're all here for, is to make the world a better place, to make it a cleaner place. And I think that theme you'll hear over and over with the next two speakers as well, even though it's a different fuel and a different way of doing it, we all have that same common goal. And then lastly for me, why fleets are using biodiesel. So we've gotten into working with more and more fleets over the last couple of years, more and more end users, you know, and we've found that, you know, they like it because it can be a cost-effective alternative fuel. In full disclosure, biodiesel is not always less expensive than the alternative fuel or to diesel, to petrodiesel, but over the long haul, especially with some federal policy and credits and different state incentives that you see in states like Iowa and Illinois and the carbon programs in California, it has become a very cost-effective fuel and something that that our fleet users like. It obviously reduces emissions and it helps engine performance as well. I mean, biodiesel, just three basic things with biodiesel that we touched on a little bit. It improves lubricity. It's got a higher cetane, so it has better combustion and performance that way. It reduces particulate matter into the fuel filter, so less regenerations and those types of things, which help the engine last longer, are just three of the basic ones. There's more, but just, you know, fleets are starting to come along with that and see that and starting to like the benefits that biodiesel set or has. And then this is just, you know, this isn't my area of expertise per se. We have a technical team that really deals with the OEMs and those types of things. And it is an ongoing process, obviously, with warranties and things like that. But we've worked really hard with OEMs to make sure that that they're going to approve blends, you know, of biodiesel. And these are just a couple examples of OEMs that we've worked with, met extensively with, done testing with, you know, all those types of things. And so it is, you know, it's a common question that gets brought up to us. And so I just wanted to show this slide just to show that it is something we are aware of, and we're working constantly with different OEMs to make sure that whatever engines you have in your trucks and your fleets, that you don't have that concern about performance or warranty issues or anything like that. So that is what we're doing with that. And with that, that concludes my presentation. I hope that I stayed on time for one, and I hope that you got some questions answered. And if you have others, then I'm happy to take them at the end. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris, for that wonderful presentation. And remember that the presenters will be joining us later for the Q&A answer session. So make sure to keep typing in your questions into the chat box. So now I'd like to go ahead and turn things over to Jason Vanderbrink, Operations Officer for Ozinga. Jason will be providing his insight on the natural gas industry. So whenever you're ready.
Thank you, Kelly. Yeah, and thank you everyone for being here and for Wisconsin Clean Cities for putting this on. I am Jason Vandenbrink from Ozinga Energy, part of the Ozinga family. And we sell compressed natural gas fuel to public customers. We provide the fuel to the Ozinga Ready Mix company, and we build and install and maintain compressed natural gas infrastructure for customers across the country. So I'd like to kind of just talk with you guys a little bit about how compressed natural gas can work for your organization, how it works for Ozinga Ready Mix, and for some of our customers. I'm gonna make sure I get the slides to change. There we go. Ozinga is a fourth generation family owned company out of Chicagoland. We're coming up on 92, 93 years. So it's a privilege to be part of a organization like this. Why did Ozinga start using CNG, and why does Ozinga Energy exist to kind of bring it to others? CNG is an American local resource. 90% of the well gas used in the United States comes from North America, as well as the nearly 100% of all the renewable natural gas, which I'll get into later. It's affordable. We found that compressed natural gas can be cost competitive, and during certain cycles, it was tremendously less expensive than diesel. It also remains very consistent on its pricing, so doesn't suffer some of the price fluctuations when you're managing fleets of diesel or gasoline. And when we talk about engines and vehicles, it eliminates the entire regen and the depth and a lot of the exhaust issues that come with the modern standards for exhaust and emissions on engines. So it's excellent to add to your fleet in that way. Abundant, there is a tremendous amount of natural gas resources already being produced in this country, as well as enormous amount of renewable sources that are coming online, and even Ozinga is getting to be a part of that. And as a fleet operator, as well as a producer, and clean. Natural gas and renewable natural gas are great ways for your fleet to reduce their tailpipe emissions and also the greenhouse gas effect. When it comes to tailpipe emissions, natural gas is as clean as it gets in the fuel marketplace near zero NOx, right out the gate on CNG engines and particulate matter drastically reduced, as well as many of the other pollutants that come out of a traditional diesel tailpipe, even after the regen and the DEF treatments that go into treating exhaust. And then on top of it, when paired with renewable sources, compressed natural gas can be, in fact, carbon negative on the overall environment. When you are capturing dairy gas or landfill gas or wastewater treatment gas that would otherwise be a heavy burden on the greenhouse effect, because methane, the primary fuel in natural gas, primary component of natural gas, is 10 to 80 times more greenhouse gas intensive than carbon dioxide, depending on the window of time you measure it on. So by capturing that, you're reducing that greenhouse effect and then burning it in an engine to reduce the consumption of fossil oils to make the diesel. So we find it to be a really great way for our company and our customers to be good stewards of the environment and improve the overall environment. I don't think I'm gonna get to use the keyboard. And so I'm gonna use my mouse. There we go. So I want to just give you a quick overview for the fleet operators out there. There weren't very many. Most folks were utilities when we saw that survey. A quick review of the infrastructure that could be in place. This also works great for local governments. We have several organizations that we work with that are local governments. You're going to have your utilities coming inbound, natural gas and electricity, your compression equipment, whatever that might be. And then one of the great resources for fleets is the time fill. So you don't have to spend time and labor hours and operational schedule on fueling vehicles. When you have hundreds of vehicles in a fleet, that can add up to multiple labor days saved per day, every day of the year, by not having each individual driver spending 10, 15, 20 minutes fueling a vehicle as part of the workday. And then a public station or a private, if not serving the public, some sort of fast fill or immediate fill, if you do have a fleet that's gonna need to refuel during a single day, if one tank of fuel is not enough. So that's kind of a breakdown of the overall CNG infrastructure when you're getting into it. Like I said, from an operational perspective, which is partly part of my background, the time savings of having every driver walk up to a truck that's full of fuel every morning is a really big advantage. And just to illustrate the diversity of applications, these are a few different ready-mix trucks that Ozinga utilizes, different styles of truck, but can all run on CNG. And then of course, there's a whole host of different types of vehicles. We see the most usage in our business in waste industry, the ready-mix companies, and we see a lot of service vans, both private and fleets, and governments, as well as squad cars. We have police districts and local governments for their trucks and vans are pretty common for fleet application of CNG vehicles. Pickup trucks as well. All of our service vehicles are dual fuel, run CNG and gasoline. So you never have to be worried about a situation where you can't fuel if there aren't CNG stations everywhere, but you can run on that CNG as often as possible. Especially when self-produced, it can be extremely cost competitive and significantly less than public pricing for gasoline or diesel. So just another image of sort of the vehicles using the CNG station. So engines, when we talk about heavy duty class 8 vehicles, Ozinga uses mostly the 9-liter or the 12-liter engines. Although we have a lot of customers that use delivery vans, service vans, that run on the 6.7. All three of these vehicles rated by the EPA for the near zero NOx and 90% reduction in particulate matter. And they are an excellent addition to our fleets. Just a little bit of chemistry. I'm not a chemist, but I like to talk about it. Gasoline, natural gas, there we go. We'll come back to it. Propane, and the next page, diesel molecule compared to the natural gas. The lamest terms that's been explained to me, when you blow up a diesel molecule, you blow that up, you make a lot of interesting stuff, hence all the tailpipe emissions that need to get managed. When you burn that natural gas molecule, got a very simple structure, reacts with oxygen, and it creates very clean CO, CO2, H2O, and not a lot of particulates, not a lot of other things that's partly why the waste, the exhaust waste from a CO, from a CNG engine is so much cleaner right off the bat without many of the exhaust cleanup that goes into diesel. Oops. For our part, our company has been able to displace over 1 million gallons of diesel per year at this point with the size of the fleet that we've converted over to natural gas, to the end of significant financial savings and a significant reduction of the carbon footprint of our concrete, which is known as a pretty carbon intensive material. Obviously, everybody needs it. Concrete is one of the most widely used building materials on Earth, but we can reduce its carbon footprint. And pricing, I mentioned this before, only a small fraction of the actual retail price or total cost buildup of a gallon of CNG is from the actual raw material of natural gas, about 20%, versus 50 to 75% of the cost of a gallon of diesel or gasoline is driven by the raw material, the barrel of oil. So even if there are fluctuations in the energy marketplace in the price of oil or the price of natural gas, most of your other costs are relatively fixed. They're the capital investment in the compression equipment and the distribution, they're the labor to service and maintain that equipment, and they're the electricity to power it. So even if natural gas, the raw material, were to spike, it would have a much smaller effect on the actual cost, total cost. Oh, and taxes. I left out taxes. Another area that's fixed and sometimes treated more favorably than gasoline or diesel. So even if fuel's prices spike, the barrel of oil or the cost of natural gas in the pipeline, that will have a much smaller effect on the actual price of your CNG fuel than it will have on gasoline or diesel. That pretty much brings me to the end of my slide deck. I'm looking forward to answering questions at the end. Love to talk about CNG and especially renewable natural gas. Didn't touch on that as much, but we are utilizing landfill gas in our fleet, and you can too. You don't have to be sitting on top of the landfill. That gas can go through the pipeline, and there's significant financial and environmental advantages to that as well. Thank you, Kelly.
Yeah, thank you, Jason, for that presentation and for sharing Ozinga's experiences with us. Now I'd like to go ahead and introduce our final speaker of the day, Steve Whaley. Steve is the Director of Autogas Business Development for the Propane Education Research Council. And Steve is going to share his insight on the propane autogas industry with us.
Thanks, Kelly. I appreciate that. And I appreciate everybody being on the webinar with us. The Propane Education Research Council exists. It's a nonprofit organization, but it exists to fund technologies that are going to advance the domestically produced very clean propane. And when we use it in a motor fuel arena, we call it autogas. So autogas is the term I'll probably use throughout this, but it's interchangeable with propane as we're doing it. But before we do that, I just want to kind of wrap our heads around what is a successful alternative energy adoption. When we went from horses and carriages to moving into diesel and gasoline, it had to have some success criteria. And so what does that success criteria look like today? I don't care if it's propane, if it's electricity, even with Chris's biodiesel or with what Jason was talking about with CNG, all of us have to meet these four criteria to be successful. It has to be a reduced amount of emissions and a significant amount of reduced emissions for it to gain any kind of sustainability today. I'm talking about it being long lasting. It has to be cheaper. If it's not less expensive than what we're currently using now, we're not going to have a sustainable adoption. We can underwrite and fund and do certain things to stimulate something, but if it's not sustainable financially in the long haul, then it's not going to continue. And we're not going to give up any performance. We're not going to give up on range that we need to have. We're not going to give up on the amount of horsepower and torque and all of those things that we need to move good services and people around. And we have to have a lot of it domestically. Now, if we have all four of these, we have a shot at making a very successful energy adoption. And it no longer becomes an alternative, it becomes mainstay, okay? So how does propane actually line up with this? Well, it's the most cost-effective energy source to reduce NOx emissions, and the Volkswagen settlement funds, more of it goes to propane for school buses because it actually reduces more NOx than any other energy source. It's a lower cost of total ownership, and that includes, you know, what changes need to be made to the vehicle, the infrastructure, and the movement of that fuel. It has as least as good, if not better, on performance without compromising on any of the range that folks need to have. It has a very high density for the amount of square footage it takes up on a vehicle. And then we have a lot of it. We used 9 billion gallons of propane domestically last year, but we sent almost 20 billion gallons overseas. Now, what I'd like to do, and if I do my job a little bit better, especially after today, some of that 19 billion going overseas is going to get rerouted here in these United States to be used a little bit more here. So what is propane? It's exactly the same fuel that you're using out on your back deck when you're doing your barbecue. Okay. It's so clean, we let it touch our food. It's commonly used for heating water, for cooking, for all the households here in the United States, as well as agriculture, forklifts, even commercial mowers. A lot of this propane comes from organic as well as renewable sources. When I mean by organic, it means it comes up from the ground, just like Jason was talking about with it's one of the natural gases. There's methane, there's ethane, there's propane and butane. All of those come up. We segregate them and we use them in their best areas of energy efficiency. It's non-toxic, means it doesn't contaminate the air or the soil or the water. You can set up a fuel station and it'll never leak into the ground. You never have to worry about contaminating the water. It evaporates in the air and is non-carcinogenic. So it's super clean for that. And that's why we have to put an odorant in it to keep it safe, because if it was ever leaking anywhere, you wouldn't know about it unless you smelled it. So why are fleets adopting propane autogas? Well, it's about the money. The total cost of ownership is less. Of course, it's much lower emissions. We'll talk about that. A lot of people don't talk about the reduced noise. Now, this reduced noise is not just for propane. It's also for natural gas, too. Everybody was used to hearing the big diesel truck coming down the road, or in this case, a school bus, and people would send out their trash when they heard the diesel, you know, garbage truck coming, or they would send out their kids to the bus stop when they heard the diesel bus coming. Well, those things got interrupted when natural gas started taking over all of the waste hauling, and then when school buses took over all propane on school buses took over all those, and people had to start using their watches instead of listening for it from 4 or 5 blocks away. There's less maintenance, increased uptime for using propane. And also, there's a big corporate image improvement for folks who are going green. But there's also employee morale and driver retention. The morale of people, you know, those who are used to pumping diesel and getting it all over themselves, coming home at the end of the day and all their clothes smelling like diesel, don't have that issue with propane. But then driver retention, you talk with Sam Hamm down in Georgia, who actually was able to give all of his drivers a huge raise from the $3,000 they were saving every year per bus. So all of that money got back into their system for the classrooms as well as for the drivers. And he has the highest driver retention for school bus drivers anywhere in the country now. So everybody's working on a path to zero emissions. We have to get there. Propane started off with doing the most with particulate matter, virtually eliminated all of the particulate matter. And in NOx reductions, our best-in-class propane school bus engine was tested by the University of West Virginia. They did a mobile emission test. Of course, everybody meets the CARB and the EPA standards, but we wanted to actually find out exactly what was being measured. So the NOx reductions were put, measurement devices were put on the best-in-class diesel versus the best-in-class propane of the same manufactured bus. They went around for several months going together all on the same route. The propane bus was 96% cleaner than the best-in-class diesel. These are huge reductions, and that's why we're getting a lot of the Volkswagen settlement monies too. Greenhouse gases has been our third target, and I'll talk a little bit more about that when we get into the renewable sections of it, but our new technologies are drastically reducing the greenhouse gases, those CO2 emissions. So fuel and maintenance cost reductions, that's total cost of ownership. Fuel is obviously much less than gasoline and diesel. Because it's all here. A lot of people like to take note of, hey, where am I at in here? And looking at Wisconsin, we're looking at prices very competitive compared to gasoline and diesel. Like Jason was mentioning, with the as well as Chris, with the advent of diesel engines having to meet certain standards, they have to add a lot of things. DEF is one of them, but they also have to add a tremendous amount of equipment that costs a lot of money to meet those ever-increasing emission standard reductions. And 2024 is another big hurdle, with another one in 2027. And diesel manufacturers are struggling to find ways of meeting those standards, but also trying to do it without adding tens of thousands of dollars to their vehicle. With propane, we don't have to do that. This is the cost of that diesel components on a particular bus. And you know, when we go to changing the oil, instead of 17 quarts in a $35 filter, we're, you know, 7 quarts in a $5 filter. It's substantially less for the preventative maintenance that goes into these as well. That's every single time you do an oil change. So who's offering what now? Let's run through these really fast. We are in school buses, law enforcement, medium duty trucks, pickup trucks, all the way across a lot of parcel and package and delivery. School buses have been our iconic success story. We have manufacturers, all three of the major manufacturers offer an option with propane now, from Bluebird, from IC, and from Thomasville. And you can see by the density of the color of Wisconsin, you guys have a lot of school buses running on propane there. So how many? 20,000, more than 20,000 school buses now are operating on propane and still growing rapidly. When school is fully open, we're moving 1.25 million kids to and from school every day. And it's not just school district, but it's contractors who are providing school transportation are also doing this because they see the substantial fuel cost savings. Just to give you an idea, I'll pick on Bluebird here for a second. This exact same Bluebird bus that you were to buy on diesel or propane or CNG or electric are listed here. A lot of people don't see how much more, especially that electric vehicle, and how much compromise there has to be on that electric vehicle for range. That propane school bus goes 400 miles. Okay, and this is why Volkswagen settlement money is a lot of it. You see the yellow is the number of buses that were funded. Blue is the number of dollars it took to do that. We have a right side up equation for adopting propane in the medium duty market. So what are the markets that are coming up behind school bus that are going to catch it here real soon? Well, food and beverage is one of them. Nestle started off with a corporate image, you know, of five, and now they're over 1,000 of their water delivery trucks. Swans has over 4,000 of their food delivery trucks. Paratransit, the shuttle buses. Every county in these United States, according to the American Disabilities Act, has to provide transportation. There's 25,000 of those vehicles out there. They use 600 gallons of fuel a month on average. And propane, when we substitute that out, we're cutting their fuel cost down by 40%. Okay. And we provide the fueling infrastructure. We'll get into that in a second. Another emerging one is the straight box trucks, that 26,000 to 33,000 GVW. And the 70,000 routes that are done for the post office are done by independent trucking companies that move that mail from distribution centers. These guys use over 1,000 gallons of fuel every month. And if you take a look just down at the bottom line, comparing all of this, this is a cost per mile. 37 cents a mile it costs on diesel and 29 cents a mile to cost on propane. It's a great return on investment. We have lots of manufacturers that are providing in this space. Roush is one of the leaders here with school buses and medium duty trucks. We also have an OEM from Freightliner Custom Chassis in that 33,000 GVW space. Greencraft has another out in California with the 0.02 ultra low NOx. Agility in Salisbury, North Carolina provides the 8.0 liter engines. Alliant Autogas is a bi-fuel system. Allow you run on gasoline or diesel, or I'm sorry, gasoline or propane in all of those vehicle platforms, as well as ICOM is another leader with providing that. Campbell Parnell focuses on one particular vehicle, and that's that Isuzu cab over, and they do it very well. So autogas infrastructure, what does it look like? We could deliver it with a wet hose from a bobtail like they do in the city of Boston, where they don't have any room for doing any diesel or gasoline or even propane refueling infrastructure. So we come in with a dual hose bobtail and fill 400 buses every single night. It's not the most cost-effective way to do it, but because of their space limitations, it was the only way to make it happen. We also have temporary refueling setups, like here on this trailer. We can move this anywhere to take care of a fleet that has to either move or they're waiting on infrastructure to get set up and they have vehicles. But more commonly, the standard private station, which is a 1,000-gallon tank with a dispenser for 50 vehicles or less, this fuel pumps at 13 gallons a minute, 24 hours a day. It only takes a 5 horsepower, 220 little 30 amp circuit to do it. It's basically a clothes dryer outlet that this thing gets plugged into to make work. It takes up a very small footprint. And as you can see here with the crash posts around it, it goes into any parking lot and it can be in all kinds of configurations, very scalable too. You could add another tank to it and keep more of your fuel on hand. As we move up, these are two 2000s. And so you can see these were put into a bus schoolyard because they wanted to go end to end to take care of the ability to fill two buses at a time. But when you have 670 buses at one location, you go up to an 18,000 gallon tank here and you can make all that work. Same kind of canopy, same kind of structure that you would use for gasoline or diesel. The dispensers can be anywhere from a few thousand dollars to just click off a number of gallons to very sophisticated merchant services cards where you can slide this in and track everything that you would do normally with gasoline or diesel. The National Fire Protection Agency has mandated by law now that all new manufacturers have to adopt the new quick connect nozzle. Basically, there's no eye protection, no gloves. All you do is you push this on, squeeze the trigger, and it fills up, like I said, 13 gallons a minute. When it's all done, it automatically kicks off, and then it's just a and then you're done. The school bus drivers really like that. Just to give you a cost analysis, a pretty sophisticated merchant services propane fueling dispensing station is going to be about $40,000 to start. I think Jason could probably let us know because he has some time fill of the CNG. We're looking at about $200,000 for 10 of those time fixed hoses. But electric, you're looking a little even more at $250,000 for those 10 fixed. But those aren't really scalable. With propane, you can have one dispenser and put in a lot more fuel behind it. So what are the technology innovations that propane is doing these days? Okay, we have a new purpose-built Cummins 6.7 liter propane engine that's now out of the lab and it's in a demonstration mode now. This thing uses the diesel block for the durability, but it has a very sophisticated head with the spark plugs and all of this being able to maximize propane's wonderful attributes. So we can go back to those really high compression ratios of the muscle cars back in the 60s. So we had a 12-to-1 compression ratio. What that translates to is very high efficiency of burning that fuel and getting great results from it. Those results are here. Just take a look at the black line that's right in here. And this is the current best diesel for that 6.7. Okay. What we did with propane is this green line. It surpasses diesel in horsepower. The 6.7 liter is 375 horsepower at 880 foot-pounds of torque. Cummins was very surprised at what they could do with propane, and we're super excited about the demonstration results. But we also got, because of the efficiencies, a tremendous amount of CO2 reduction emissions here as well. So where's the future of propane? Well, it's in renewable. So we're going to touch on renewable. 10 years ago, not many states were caring about that. But now we have over 50% of our nation's population saying comprehensive greenhouse gas reductions are important to us. And so we didn't even make this happen. So we introduced renewable propane. Renewable propane has a really low carbon intensity. This is renewable propane's carbon intensity comparisons per state to the electric grid today. Already, propane has a less carbon intensity in 38 states. But when we go to renewable propane, we're better than the electric grid in every single state except Vermont, which gets all of its electricity from hydro in Quebec. So we are able to say, okay, well, the electric grid is going to get cleaner. So what happens when 2035 gets here? Okay, well, the best case renewable propane along with renewable DME blend is still better than the best projections of the electric grid in 2035. So this is a renewable propane is something you don't have to wait for. You can actually get some now from REG. REG produces renewable propane as a byproduct of the renewable diesel, and so are many of the other diesel processing plants doing the same. It's the same vehicles, the same infrastructure, and you don't have to wait. If you want to find out anything more about what we're doing with propane, just go to propane.com. We'll take care of you. Kelly, thanks so much.
Thank you, Steve, for that wonderful presentation. Now I'd like to go ahead and welcome back all of our presenters for the Q&A session. So please continue to type your questions into the chat box. We do have some wonderful questions already. So I'll just go ahead and get started. The first question, Steve, I'll ask to you since you just spoke. For Steve, are there any misconceptions about the safety of propane autogas? How are you working with first responders to help make them more aware of the perception of safety versus the reality?
Sure. Now, propane, like any other combustible fuel, we wouldn't be able to light it and grill our steaks on the back deck with it if it wasn't something that was burnable. And so with any burnable fuel, there's always safety issues. But Hollywood likes to, you know, take things like the Casino Royale, James Bond taking his 9mm Walther and hitting the embassy's propane tank and watching it blow up. Well, basically, he wouldn't do anything but chip the paint with that thing. So the air fuel ratio of propane is actually more narrow than gasoline. So it's a safer fuel than gasoline, and because of it not being able to contaminate water or any other soil sources, it's much safer than conventional fuels.
Kelly, I think you're muted.
Kelly, we can't hear you.
We're not able to hear you, Kelly.
You guys can't read my lips? Sorry about that. This one's for Jason. Ozinga is both a CNG provider and a CNG fleet user. What would you say to a fleet that is considering CNG but isn't sure where to start?
We'd love to sit down with you. The CNG is an extremely flexible type of fuel. It can be scaled to meet a fleet of 4 to 400. And the solution is going to depend on a lot of different factors unique to your situation. So don't rush into anything. Don't look for or accept the one-size-fits-all solution. With the right partner, you can definitely figure out the best cost-effective, reliable solution for your CNG needs for your fleet.
This next one, Chris, I'll give to you. It is a two-part question, so please have me repeat it if you need me to. Can you please talk about biodiesel availability with REG, specifically blends over B5 in the Milwaukee area? Also, can you talk about precision blending terminal facilities in the Milwaukee area, if there are any?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question, and that's something that we continue to try and grow in that area. So REG specifically doesn't have any terminal positions in the Milwaukee area. Like I said, we have the refinery in Madison, but that's one of the business development goals that we are continually trying to push, is to try to get more infrastructure and terminals. Wisconsin is considered a growth state for us, so we're trying to not only have the refinery there, but to get into more terminal locations in Milwaukee and Madison so we can offer those blends. And that's just that's an ongoing process for us to find partners. You know, the big thing for us is that because we're not a diesel producer, we have to find a diesel partner where we can, you know, purchase that diesel from at a competitive price and actually have a position in terminals that, you know, our partners have positions in. And so that's an ongoing business development process for us. And so that's a long answer. The short answer is we don't have a blending, you know, facility or a terminal in the Milwaukee area right now. It's something we are continually trying to work on.
This next question can go to any speaker. What types of responses do you get from drivers when they make the switch from traditional diesel or gasoline to alternative fuels?
I'll jump in. I'll kind of steal Stephen's story from his, but I had a driver once tell me, he was telling me a funny story about when the company switched to CNG and his wife told him, "I don't believe you're going to work anymore because you don't come back stinking like diesel exhaust every day. I think you're just going to the bar every day." And he thought he was hilarious telling that story, but that's one of the responses. I will say the drivers don't like change. They like things to stay the same. So they like their engine to sound the same. They like it to feel the same when they mash the pedal. And I think all of our vehicles feel differently. The way the engines are tuned, the way the fuels combust, they're timed differently, but given time, the vehicles run just as reliably and with all the necessary power and torque to serve the purpose in our fleet.
I'll add one more to that. You know, nobody wants to compromise on performance, and they think, you know, oh, it's an alternative, so they're not going to have the horsepower and torque that they had before, and they're always very surprised that they do. But one story of a school bus driver, because of her respiratory issues, had to retire. And she was a very, very well-known and very respected, but her doctor would not allow her to be around those diesel fumes anymore. But when their fleet adopted propane and she was able to get back in the driver's seat and be able to drive and continue and not go into that retirement because of the very clean atmosphere that she had now, it was life changing.
Yeah, and I would say, just to add to what Steve and Jason said, it's the same story for us too. I think with any change, you get hesitation and people think that it's, to Steve's point, it's an alternative fuel, so my performance is going to be different in my engine. But we get all the same feedback that they get, that it doesn't smell as bad, it runs, you know, cleaner, it sounds better. We have an example as well, Steve, of someone in the Chicago area that wasn't with school buses, but just with a fleet of trucks that retired, and even when they went to using 20% biodiesel, it made it so much better for them that person can come back to work. You know, you're always going to get the skepticism in the beginning. I think overwhelmingly for the three of us, we find probably that once people get into it and they're using it on a regular basis, they either one see no change or they see, a better outcome than what they had before. That's been my experience.
Thank you. And for this last question, Steve, someone wanted to pick your brain in particular. If a school bus garage has a maintenance garage with a pit equipped with electricity, would you recommend an assessment to determine if modifications are needed to safely work on the buses?
Well, the immediate lawyer answer is you always have to check with your local fire marshal for any of those safety features. Okay, that has to happen. That's going to be the final authority on what goes on. But generally speaking, any gasoline or diesel maintenance facility that is up to code is already going to be satisfied with propane. Because propane is heavier than air, like gasoline and diesel, it's going to go down. It's not going to go up into the ceiling and have an evacuation system that you're going on there. But to the specific point of a pit, because it's heavier, like gasoline and diesel, it's going to find its way down. And so any ignition source, like even a, you know, propane hot water heater, you always put it up on still so that if there ever is a leak, the ignition source isn't down there where the fuel can actually gather. So, but check with your local fire marshal. But generally speaking, any maintenance facility that is set up for gasoline and diesel and comes up to that code is going to meet it for propane as well.
Perfect. Thank you. And that's all the time we have for the questions. questions, but thank you all for those wonderful questions. If you have any additional questions that didn't get answered, please feel free to reach out to our speakers directly. And thank you again to all of our wonderful speakers for presenting today. We appreciate your insight in the latest in alternative fuels and infrastructure. And thank you to all of our attendees for joining us today. We appreciate your time and hope you enjoyed the first installment in the Sustainable Transportation Series. Please make sure to join us for our next installment in the series, Funding Your Sustainable Fleet, at 1 p.m. on September 17th. We hope to see you there and for all of the webinars in our series. We also encourage you to join us at the Transportation and Innovation Expo on June 10th of 2021. All of the information, including registration information, is available online at wisconsinclean.org, and this posting of the webinar will be available on our website as well. So thank you again for joining us and have a great rest of the day.
Thanks, everybody.